We'll do a couple of sentences which we did last time and continue. But now she stirred. Her life shared a cosmic load. It is not her personal pain. It is actually the entire grief, sorrow, suffering, the mortality itself of this mortal world. It is to that she is rising. She shared a cosmic load. At the beginning of this canto, rather at the end of the previous canto, we had man lifted up the burden of his fate. All that man could do is to lift up the burden of his fate. He cannot solve the cosmic problem. He cannot solve the fundamental issue of death which is present in this mortal world. His fate, to some extent, he is able to bear. He can push himself to some extent. But now, in contrast of that, Savitri is lifting up the cosmic load. Not the individual's fate, but the fate of the cosmos itself. That is important. But now she stirred. So this is on a totally different scale altogether. At the summon of her body's call, body's voiceless call, this is the most significant phrase in the Aurobindonian psycho-spirituality. Body's call. No spiritual individual has so far in the entire history of creation understood the body's call. Body's voice is there. Body is silently, quietly telling something. Yes, I am here. What are you going to do for me? Body is constantly asking that question. But none of the spiritual seekers was able to really listen to that call and do something in response to it. But here, Savitri is awaking to it. At a saman, she is able to hear that call of the body. Saman, she is attending to it. A strong, far-winging spirit travels back. That is important. Body's voiceless call is the only thing which can take you to the past, back in time, where from the body's ache has arisen. It is not today, it is not now, it was not yesterday. Years ago, right at the beginning of the whole process, how the body is suffering because it is born of inconscience. It is to that she has to go and attend. A strong, see, that is required. As long as, and unless you are strong, you cannot travel back. The body's voiceless call, you cannot bear. Nobody had a strength until now. Savitri has that. Her far-winging spirit travel back to the yoke of ignorance and fate, back to the labor and stress of mortal day. She is going back in time to the beginning of time itself, to the zero moment of time itself, at the Big Bang moment of time itself. She is going back to that, back to the yoke of ignorance and fate, back to the labor and stress of mortal day, lighting. And while she is going through the darkness, she is lighting a pathway to strange symbol. She is seeing all those dreams which are there present, which were not distinct at all so far, to strange symbol dream across the ebbing, the seas of sleep, sea of ignorance, sea of inconscience itself. They are all now receding because the pathway is getting lighted by her, while she is going back, lighting a pathway to strange symbol dream across the ebbing, the seas of sleep, sleep of inconscience itself. She is going back to that, and it is there perhaps she is going to find out what the body is trying to tell to her, why that body's ache is there. It is there, she has to go and discover it, you see. To some extent, in the sadhana of Ashwapati, we have a similar instance also. He has also found out that kind of a thing. But now here, Savitri has to attain to it, has to discover it, find the root cause of it. What is the evil at the root of life? That she has to find and discover and strike out. You see, that is what she has to do. In fact, we'll see what Savitri, what Ashwapati has also done in that context. You see, we see that across the evening, we see the scene, her house of nature felt an unseen sway. Because she's going back now, entire house of nature, her physical, mental, vital, everything is being awakened, and they are feeling a kind of a change now, illuminating swiftly for life's darkened rooms. What was lying until now, unknown in the darkness, that is becoming obvious to her, clear, distinct to her. And memory's casement opened in the hour, and the tired feet of thought approached her doors. Savitri's doors of sensibility, of cognition, of understanding, of knowledge, they are opening up. Memory's casement, we have seen last time in considerable detail, this thing, casement, the windows, and this phrase, this word casement is actually the Kitsian phrase itself. In this case, magic windows were there. Here it is memory's casement, memory's time. He is not able to explain what kind of windows were there. Those casements were there. But here we have got a very distinct description. Yes, they are the casements of memory. Where does this memory come from? How does that come out, open out? The windows of memory have opened out. Means was, what has really happened? What has really happened? It is some kind of a psychic memory. It is a psychic being which is there, which is seeing all the dreams through which he is passing, the pathway she is lighting. It is through this psychic experience she is now capturing back all those old things. So this memory, the psychic memory of Savitri, because she had been there all along, she was unaware of all this. She was kind of in a sleeping state all along. But now the psychic memory has awoken, and therefore all these things are coming into view to her. And memory's casement opened on the hours, on the passing time, on the process of time, the sequence of time that she is able to see all the things. And the tired feet of thought approached her doors. Well, they wanted to go away and forget about the whole thing, but now, because of the memory has come back, the feet, the thought, which were lying dull, inert, obtuse, they are now coming back, and she is attentive to them. All came back to her. All came back to her. Everything is there. All. The entire history of evolution, starting from the beginning of evolution itself, how things happened, how things began, everything has come back to her. Suddenly, all came back to her. What is that all? Earth and love and do. Earth, Bhumi, love, prema and ananda, do, mrityu, yama, death. Everything has come back to her. They are there at the origin of this inconscient process. At the beginning of evolution itself, they are present there. Earth and love and do. We have already seen what these three are. Earth is a significant center to concentrate the effort of transformation. In the entire cosmic manifestation, you have chosen a place where you work out all the details so that from that place they can spread around and the divine manifestation can go all around here. Earth, Bhumi, Prithvi. Prithvi itself, the word Prithvi itself means which expands, which grows, which expands. Bhumi also means which widens, you see. Earth and love. Love, of course, is the divine himself who is there seated at the center of this inconscient beginning. The Divine has plunged into the void and He is seated there. He is the inconscient Vishnu, according to the Puranic tradition. He is, according to the mother, Satyavan himself. Satyavan in the first avatar. When the horror of separation was seen, the Divine plunged into the inconscient and He is seated there. By His presence only things could be solved. Because the Divine is present there now, things can happen, you see. The evolution can begin. In fact, the plunge of the Divine Soul in the inconscience itself, that is the beginning of the process of evolution. When does it happen? There is a total involution. There is a total void. The Divine plunges. The moment the Divine plunges as Satyavan, from that moment onward, the evolution begins. So the Big Bang moment of evolution is that plunge of love, you see. He is, of course, obviously trapped in the inconscience, in the zero. He is in the grip of death, as the story of Savitri says. In the other description, well, all these descriptions are there, but essentially the truth behind all the descriptions is the same. Here, the Divine has plunged, has become love. And it is Satyavan in the story of Savitri. In the Vedic story, the Divine Mother, the Omniscient, the Goddess, the Supreme Goddess, Aditi, the first Goddess herself, the creative power of the Supreme Himself, Aditi. She has 8 sons, and she has left the 8th son in the inconscience. And with the other 7 sons, she has gone back to the transcendent. The 8th son, whom she has left behind, is, well, Aditi, and his 8 sons, they are called Adityas. Adityas means son, S-U-N's, sons of various kinds of sons. So, that 8th son is in the mortal world. She has left him here in the mortal world. He is equivalent to Satyavan. In the other story and the other narration, he is equivalent to love in the story of involution. This 8th son, his name in the Veda is given as Martand. Martand, 8th son. He is the mortal egg. And it is he who is situated, located in the inconscient here. And it is he who has to come out. So Aditi has done something very purposefully to leave him behind, so that the process of evolution can start and things can move forward. The other 8 sons, the other 7 sons, with them she has gone back to the realms of truth and light, Satyam, Ritam, Brahat, the transcendent. She has gone back to them, you see. But the 8th son she has left here behind purposefully. Then, of course, doom, death, is the product of pure inconscience. It is, of course, the Supreme Himself in another form. Doom. What does the doom do? What is his purpose? His purpose is to pull back everything into nothing. To bring back everything. That is the doom. To swallow up whatever is trying to come out. You see, that is death. That is doom. That is mrityu. See, mrityu. See. So now, obviously, these three, earth and love and doom, they are here as constant disputants, fighting, quarreling, asserting themselves. Earth wants to expand, carry the expression. Love is there in a way, in a very passive sense. He is just there. His presence is enough to things, for things to happen. Whatever has to be got done for love, it will be done by Savitri, by the power of evolution which is there in Savitri, you see. Mrityu, doom. He is there in response to the appearance of life in the creation. When life entered into the material world, when matter was life, without life, and when the objects in matter cried for life, please come and save us. When the gods were locked in matter, they prayed to her, and she obliged them and she entered into matter. She sacrificed herself. She entered into matter. But the response which she received was the response of death. Life met death in matter. And now she is entirely under the control of death, you see, life. So that is why earth and love and doom, they have become ancient, starting from the beginning of this whole creation of evolution, disputant, encircled her. So Savitri is now, see, this cannot happen unless she her psychic memory is now fully awakened. She is going back to the starting point of the whole thing. Ancient disputant, encircled her, like giant figures wrestling in the night. So they are surrounding her. The goddess from the dim, inconscient goddess. All these three are goddess, earth and love and doom. They are the powers of the divine himself in this situation here. From the dim, inconscient born, awoke the struggle and the pan divine. That is the beauty of the whole thing. That itself has a kind of a quality of the divine in it, you see. Unless that is born, things cannot move forward, you see. And in the shadow of a flaming heart, at the somber center of the dire debate, a guardian and unconsoled appear, inheriting the long agony of the globe, this godlike pain which has come here, he is inheriting the agony of the globe. He is holding all the agony in him, and therefore he is godlike pain. Yes. In fact, if you are able to deal with him, so to say, if you are able to transform him, godlike pain, then you have solved the basic problem. Because it is he who is narrating the entire agony of this creation, of this universe, of this globe. If you are able to solve his agony, you have conquered everything. It means that. So basically, inheriting the long agony of the globe, a stone still figure of high and godlike pain, stared into space, his fist, regardless eyes, that saw griefs, timeless depths, but not life's goal. Timeless depths of griefs, timeless depths. That is what he sees. God of pain can see only griefs, timeless depths. Timeless, starting from the beginning of the self creation. It is all that he sees. But he cannot see what that pain is for. The aim of life is not there. The aim of life will be seen only when this godlike pain becomes God of bliss. When pain becomes bliss, then life's goal becomes distant, clear, vivid. You see what was all that for. So basically, to convert this godlike pain into the god of bliss is the central problem. Then you see the lame aim of life. What is the aim of life? That the powers of the spirit should manifest in this material creation. There should be love, beauty, joy, sweetness, happiness, power, knowledge. All those things should come here. That is the goal of life, the manifestation of the divine qualities, divine potentialities to come into creation is the aim of life here. And that aim of life can be seen only when godlike pain becomes of something of bliss, you see. When pain becomes bliss, you see. Actually, let us read some descriptions of how Ashwapati experienced this pain when he entered into the inconscient depth, in the depth of inconscient. 60.10 onwards. A dense and nameless nothing, conscious, mute, which seemed alive but without body or mind, lusted all being to annihilate that it might be forever mute and soul. It might be nude and so all. As in a shapeless beast, intangible jaws gripped, strangled, all that lusting, viscous blot, attracted to some black and giant mouth and swallowing throat and a huge belly of doom. Huge belly of doom. So it is swallowing up everything. Huge belly of doom. His being from its own vision disappeared. Ashwapati is not able to see himself in that belly of doom. His being from its own vision disappeared, drawn towards depths that hungered for its fall. Yes, that hunger is there, that doom is there. It wants to swallow him up, dear Sim. A formless void suppresses struggling brain. Formless void. Void had a form otherwise also. Formless void suppress his struggling brain. A darkness grim and cold oppress his flesh. A whispered grey suggestion chilled his heart. Hailed by serpent force from his warm home and dragged to extinction in blank vacancy. Life clung to his seat with cause of gasping breath. Lapped was his body by a tenebrous tongue. His body, left was his body by a tenebrous tongue. Existence mothered, travailed to survive. Hope strangled, perished in his empty soul. Belief and memory abolished, died, and all that held the spirit in its course. Everything vanished to see. So that is the nature of this hollow abyss, unconsoled abyss. There crawl through every tense and aching nerve. See, that's the physical body's pain, you see. Tense and aching nerve, leaving behind a poignant, vague, quaking trail, a nameless and unutterable fear. That's the fear there. As a sea nears a victim, sound and still, the approach alarmed his mind forever dumb of an implacable eternity. Here we have got unconsoled abyss. Here it is implacable eternity of pain inhuman and intolerable. This he must bear. You see, that is the yogic capacity he must have. He has to meet, you see. If he has to conquer this godlike pain, that is the kind of a capacity we have to have. This he must bear, his hope for heaven, forget about heaven. He must ever exist without extensions beam. And then we have got 64.37. A light was with him, an invisible hand was laid upon the error and pain. Why this pain?
Very famous lines.
Pardon?
Famous lines.
Yeah.
Yeah.
A light, because light was with him, an invisible hand was laid upon the error and the pain. Why this body's ache? He has laid his hand upon that ache, you see. Was laid upon the error and the pain till it became a quivering ecstasy. So there's no pain there when that hand is laid on the pain itself, you see. The shock of sweetness of an arm's embrace. He saw in night the eternal shadowy way. Who is there after all behind this night? The eternal himself. New death for a seller in the house of life. In destruction felt creation's hasty pace. New loss as a piece of a celestial gain. And hell as a shortcut to heaven's gates. See, unless you go through that, you cannot peace. So after bearing all that pain, his nose and flesh had become so much. His body was lapped by the tenebrous tongue. Lapped by tenebrous tongue, you see. When you are able to bear that kind of a thing, then it becomes a shortcut to heaven.
It's Vedic. Veda also writes this.
Yes.
Is it really Aurobindian?
Yeah.
The Veda already says this.
Veda also says that.
Yeah.
Indirectly. Yeah. Not so vividly. The Vedic experience does not speak that way. I mean, it says of body's anguish, the body's suffering, the poison that is there in the body, but it does not go to the vividness of this.
This goes a step further.
This, well, they might not have described it, does not mean that they didn't realize it or they didn't experience it. So we can't say stay further. Here, it is becoming definite, it is becoming purposeful, it is becoming intentional, because now moment has come that you have to take care of this God-like pain. You have to experience, you have to find the solution. You are pinpointing it now, specifically. So that moment was not there during the Vedic time. The Rishi, he used to take his body and hung it in front of the sun. But the body was not able to bear the sunlight. Sunlight, the supreme light, the supramental light, he was not able to hold, you see. He was not able to hold it. So he had to kind of give up that attempt, you see. What was the reason, what was the cause? That they did not discover at that time. So in that sense, this is described definitely, absolutely, for the first time, with that distinctness, with that distinct clarity, and the elaborateness with which the whole thing follows, you see. And in the shadow of her flaming heart, in the shadow of her flaming heart, she sees a shadow in her heart, a guardian who is there sitting, God-like being. He is guarding it. He is guarding it with a purpose. Because unless he is fully taken care of, the problem of having conscience cannot be completely solved. He is guarding it. Yes, you may do this, you may have this joy, that joy, but that does not basically solve the problem otherwise. So in order to save, to guard the whole thing, you have to kind of put it back, you see. So in a certain sense, in a very negative way, he is helping that you do attend to all the things completely, fully. For the inconscient too is infinite. The more you run, the more you stretches, you see. That's what Ashwati has realized, you see. So in order to solve it, in other words, here you are really going to the root of things. Back in time, back at the starting point itself, when earth and love and doom had appeared at the starting point. You are going back to the point. I don't think anybody had gone to that original point. They have seen, they have got some type of glimpse and all that. Puranas has some kind of descriptions of that. But the solution of the creation was not there. Perhaps it was not to be there also. Perhaps the kind of an evolutionary preparation which was required for things to happen was not there. You have to build up certain things before you come to that point, you see. So in the course of time, in the course of evolutionary history, things were done, accomplished. Now a moment has come that they can be tackled. And therefore the divine avatar comes and starts attending that thing straight away, you see. The guardian, therefore he's the guardian, you see. He's doing some good job, maybe, inheriting the long agony of the globe. Long agony of the group, inheriting, he's holding in him, you see, a stone, still figure of high and God-like pain. That is what I was telling you last time. The whole rock which is there in the Shalvapurs, what we have seen in the Book of Destiny, in the Destiny meeting place, Savitri is seeing that whole rock of Shiva, blue-throated Shiva, there you see. A stone, still figure of high and God-like pain. Stared into space with fixed, regardless eye that saw grief's timeless depths, but not life's goal. That is important to see both grief's timeless depths and also life's goal. That is possible only when pain is transformed into bliss. Afflicted by his harsh divinity, his godlike pain, his harsh divinity. Bound to his throne, he waited unappeased the daily oblation of her unwept tears. Savitri is counting day, now 1 month is remaining, now 1 week is remaining, now few days are remaining. constantly counting you. And she's offering her tears. What is going to happen to my husband? She has no knowledge of that. That is what we got in the storyline, you see. She has no knowledge. She is constantly weeping and offering her tears. Tears themselves are the oblations. In the Sanskrit tradition, in the Indian tradition, Vedic tradition, you offer water, oblation like that, you see. So that is self, argya, they call it, what we call it, argya. So that is self, the tears themselves are the argya Savitri is offering to this god, because he's a god, you see. All bound his throne, he waited unappeased, he waited unappeased, he remains unsatisfied, implacable. No thirst can be satisfied. Affected by his harsh divinity, bound to his throne, he waited unappeased, the daily oblation for Angayapti. We'll read a few sentences, what we got in the Book of Yoga beginning. 115.7. We have seen that thing earlier, but we'll read again quickly. Then listening to the thunder's fatal crash in the night, Savitri is listening, you see, and the fugitive pattering footsteps of the shower, and the long unsatisfied panting of the wind, and sorrow muttering in the sound vexed night. The grief of all the world came near. The grief of all the world came near to her. Night darkness seemed her future's ominous face. The shadow of her lover's doom arose, and fear laid hand upon her mortal heart. She is now seeing tomorrow this man is going to die, and she is laying her hand upon her. And fear laid hand upon her mortal heart. The moment's swift and ruthless rage alarmed her thoughts, her mind remembered Narad's date. A trembling moved accountant of her riches. She reckoned the insufficient days in between. Now there are only few days remaining in between, you see. She reckoned the insufficient days in between. A dire expectation knocked at her brain. Dreadful to her were the footsteps of the hours. The hours are approaching and she is kind of afraid. Grief came, a passionate stranger to her gate. Passionate stranger. Savitri never knew grief, but now he is coming as a stranger to her. Stranger to her gate, banished. When in his arm, in his Satyavan's arm, banished when in his arm, out of her sleep, it rose at morn to look into her face. The more she plunged into love, that anguish drew her deepest grief from the sweetest gulf arose, you see. Very dramatic also, you see. He waited unappeased. Thus, in the silent chamber of her soul, cloistering her love to live with secret grief, because she alone knows it. She does not want to reveal to her lover secret grief. She dwelt like a dumb priest with hidden gods, unappeased by the worldless offering of her day. She is constantly offering herself to these gods. Here he got unappeased, he waited unappeased. Unappeased by the worldless offering of her days, lifting to them her sorrow like frankincense, her life, the altar, herself, the sacrifice. She is doing like that daily. He waited unappeased, that is what Savitri is doing here. And she uses here, lifting to them her sorrow like frankincense, her life, the altar. She has become, that itself has become yajna, kunda, altar. Herself, the sacrifice, she has offered herself in that. Sorrow like frankincense. Frankincense, one of the gifts which was given by the three magi to Devi Jai, Devi Christ, you see. Gold, mahir, and frankincense. Frankincense, the mother says, it symbolizes the immortality of the physical.
The invocation?
Or the physical. Immortality of the physical.
Frankincense?
What the invocation?
Frankincense, one of the three gifts, gold, supra metal riches, Mahir, the vital purity and offering of life, and frankincense, the immortality of the body. Immortality of the body. So this is, he is not using frankincense just for the sake of poetry. There is a certain occult sense also behind the use of these words, you see. Down to his throne, he waited unappeased, daily oblation. Day after day, she is offering herself. She has made her life a sacrifice, a yajna kunda. And she is offering her body, frankincense. Sorrow like frankincense, her life, the altar, herself, the sacrifice. And again, he uses the same word here, unappeased. What we got here, he waited unappeased, you see. The poet is using the same adjective, unappeased. Bound to his throne, he waited unappeased, the daily oblation of her unwept tear. Obviously, she's not going to cry and shed tears, you see. Why she will not shed tears? Because it will be seen by others. And then it will spoil it, you see. So she is weeping, but the tears are not coming out, you see. Now that is a tremendous capacity also, you know, to hold back your tears, you see. To hold back your tears, unwept tears. All the fierce question of man's hours relieved. Man's fierce question. We don't understand our own thing of mortality, of death, of ignorance, of suffering. That is the fierce question of man. It is she now who is attending to that directly. The daily oblation of her unwept tears. All the fierce question of man's hours relieved. The sacrifice of suffering and desire. Earth offers to the immortal ecstasy began again. Beneath the eternal hand. Savitri sacrifice. She has made her life an altar. Sorrow of frankincense and all that thing. It is that sacrifice is being done by Savitri under the eternal hand. The Supreme Himself is seeing and guiding and holding everything in place. The sacrifice. Now, earth offers to the immortal ecstasy. That sorrow, that frankincense, that altar, earth is constantly offering. In fact, the yajna of earth is constantly going on. Her mortal state, she wants to come out of that thing. And it is that constantly going on. To whom? That the sorrow will change into joy, ecstasy. Earth offers to the immortal ecstasy, ananda. Immortal ecstasy, ananda. Began again. Savitri has started then. In fact, unless it is done by Savitri, unless that sacrifice is done by Savitri under the eternal hand, there is no fulfillment of earth's offering her sorrow and suffering to the eternal ecstasy. Eternal ecstasy of the earth, eternal ecstasy will bless, so to say, the earth. When Savitri's yajna under the eternal hand is successfully carried through. Awake, she endured the moment, Sri man. Awake, she endured, Savitri, endured the moment's eternal Sri Ma. Now, see, it is not a question of months and weeks and days, it is a question of not even hours, but of moments. Now, he is going to die. It is in the Shalva woods, in the forest. It is going to happen now, shortly, any moment. Awake, she endured the moment. Siridma, pact. Sirid means pact, heavily packed. March, and looked on his green, smiling, dangerous world. That is his destined spot where death is going to take place. Awake, she endured. She endured, she is now ready to face the moment of death. he endured all that grief, etc., etc. She has now gathered herself, and she has now kind of yogically gathered everything into herself and put her own force in it. In fact, she endured, it is a tremendous yogic state of Savitri already present, you see. Ashwapati also endured, his back was lapped by tenebrous tongue. He endured, you see. She endured the moment, Saritma, and looked on his grain, smiling, dangerous. She triple edged, grain, smiling. Well, it is all beautiful, yet it is dangerous because it is going to happen here. And how the ignorant cry of living things, of living birds, animals, they don't know what is going to happen. Nobody knows around, you see. Savitri alone knows that thing. Awake, she endured the moment in Saritma and looked on his grain, on this grain, smiling, dangerous. Triple-edged grain, smiling, dangerous, you see. And how the ignorant cry of living things, amid the trivial sounds, the unchanging scene, her soul arose, confronting time and fate. The serried march of moments is coming to the moment of truth now. She has gathered everything now in her soul. Amid the trivial sound and changing scene, her soul arose, her soul arose. So, that is what I'm saying. Now, in other words, that condition of grief, that sacrifice itself is so yogic that she is able to meet, she is able to meet any kind of eventuality. She is not going to be afraid of anything now. Yes, come, we'll see what is going to happen. Her arose, confronting time and fate. The moment of death is arriving soon. Immobile in herself, she gathered force. That is the most important condition. You have to remain gathered within yourself in the face of adversity, difficulty, even in the most difficult circumstance. You have to gather, you have to remain calm, immobile, shant, calm, tranquil. You have to remain tranquil. So whatever may be the difficulty, however severe it might be, if you remain calm, that difficulty will not touch you. Not only that, it will not touch you, you will have force in you which will be able to meet that challenge, that difficulty. Immobile in herself, she gathered force. She gathered force from within her own soul, because it is her soul that arose from her own soul. Actually, on the day of death of Satyavan, as we've seen earlier also, Savitri gets up early in the morning, gets ready. She offers her prayer to the statue of Durga, carved on a stone by Satyavan himself. He has carved the statue of Durga. She is the goddess of protection. She is the one who will give strength and protection completely. She goes there and offers a prayer to her. Now the day has come. She gathered force. It is that Durga's force which is there now present in her soul. And she is now ready to meet any eventuality. Come what may, yes, I am ready. That is the kind of a yogic preparation which is necessary if you have to meet the calamity, the difficulty. The whole description is that Savitri is now going to approach the fated day. And on this day, this was the day when Satyavan must die, on this particular day. That is how the canto ends. This was the day when Satyavan must die. What a line.
Why is this the day when Satyavan must die?
All that is being described, when she gathered force, all that thing, it is on this day.
But it is still in the in the future. It's not on that day.
Her soul arose, man, on the day when Satyavana should die. Her soul arose. I mean, the trivial sound and changing, looked at his grain, smiling, awake, she endured the moments, his moments, spirit march on arriving at his day.
But it is not that day, I mean, the day is coming, she still has to find her soul and all that.
This is the description, this is the description of what is going to happen on the fated day.
Yes. On that day she will die when she is
old. This is the description of what is going to happen on the fated day.
Okay. Premonition.
Well, you can call it premonition. Actually, as I have been saying, this whole canto, although in a certain sense describes the terrestrial events which are going to happen in the life of Savitri, it is something which is already written in her book of life, in the transcendent. Everything is there, you see. With the sky for the page, a myth of Savitri was written up there. That is what we have seen in the first section already. What is the myth of Savitri? The story of Savitri is already written up there with the sky for a page. In the transcendent, the story of Savitri is written. Now it is that story which is going to kind of unfold here. And that is how it is going to unfold, is what is described up there. Later on, when Savitri takes the physical birth and goes through the whole process, etc., these things will happen. So this is the myth of Savitri, which is written on the sky for the page, what we are saying. In the transcendent, it is already described there. That is how it is holding unfold. Now, there are a lot of things here. Earth offers to the immortal, began again in the eternal hand. It means that, see, the sacrifice of suffering and desire, earth offers to the immortal ecstasy. She is constantly offering it right from the beginning of her appearance. A psychic being is always offering to the supreme, to the ecstasy. Began again in the verse, Savitri has now completely identified herself with the soul of the earth. This line, this whole thing is in fact a complete identification of Savitri with the soul of the earth. They are not two parallel things. The sacrifice of suffering and desire earth offers to the immortal ecstasy began again beneath the eternal hand. It is the identification of Savitri with the earth soul. And obviously, because the sacrifice is under the eternal hand, the Supreme Himself is carrying things forward with His hand, you see. Because it is the eternal hand, there is certainty, there is the assurance, there is the definiteness of the success. It is bound to success. Whatever may be the difficulties, whatever may be the oppositions, they will be gone away. They will be. There is a certainty, assurance of that thing. When the eternal hand is there, there is certainty of the yajna yielding the desirable result, bringing the desirable goal, obviously. Savitri recognizes that eternal hand holding her hand and performing the yajna. It is not Savitri who is doing the yajna. It is the eternal hand who is holding her hand and doing the yajna. Offering ahutis. No wonder the packed moments march in great glory and haste. When the eternal hand is now the moments are moving swiftly. The time is coming. March in great glory and haste. The press of events has brought the grim, smiling, dangerous world to the fore. The ignorant cry of living things is heard. The soul of Savitri rises and looks straight, looks directly at time and fate of your singular. The moment has arrived, the fate is going to be met. She is ready to strike. Savitri is ready to strike. Immobile in herself, she gathered for immobile in herself. This line, immob. I am. I'll in herself. That is the first way. Immobile, that is I am. Then this. Spirit, herself, I am. She gathered, again I am. Gathered force, again I am. So that's the meticulous. Now, in contrast to that, this was the day when Satyavan must die. It's a very complex line. This was, in a way, Sipirik, the day when Satyavan must die. This is Sipirik, the day is an I am. When Sat, that is an again I am. Sipirik, I am. Satyavan. Satyavan, that is again a pirik. So you have got I am pirik, I am pirik. Must die, you can now have it, must die or must die, depend upon how you want to. If you stress must, then it becomes spontaneous. Must die, it becomes an I am, you see. Now, there are many variations in reading this line. This was the day when Satyavan must die. Let us say, the first foot itself, you can read it very quietly. This was the day when Satyavan must die, you see, very quietly. Yes. Otherwise, you can also say, this was the day when Satyavan must die. You can give stress on this, then it becomes a talkie. This was the day when Satyavan must die. Or you can have, this was the day when Satyavan must die, you see. Now, it all depends upon how you want to see. This was the day when Satyavan must die. There is a difference between the enunciation of all the three. This was the day, Pirik. This was Praki. This was I am. You see, it depends on how you want to pronounce it, you see. Now, the line demands a certain kind of an enunciation. The lion does not want anywhere any kind of unusual emphasis. Must I? No. Must I? Quietly. The whole thing in a very sober, quiet manner. This was the day when Satyavan must die. So very quietly it kind of shows. And it's a line which keeps on ringing throughout the epic. This was the day when Satyavan must die. At every important moment in the story of Savitri, as if you remember this line, this was the day when Satyavan must die, this was the day when Satyavan must die. It kind of keeps on tolling all the while, constantly. I will pronounce it as, this was the day when Satyavan must die. This was a spirit, the day, of course, an I am, when Satya, again, an I am. One, spirit, must die, again, an I am, very quietly. This was the day when Satyavan must die. Now, there was a comment by Amal Kiran when this line was shown to Amal Kiran in the beginning, the earlier draft. He says this line looks very bald. Very bald. I mean, it has no content at all, no poetic. This was the day when Satyavan must die. There is nothing in it, you see. Very bald. And Shivendra said, it is meant to be purposefully, not bald, but bare. Bare, without any embellishment, without any trailing effect at all. No trailing effect, nothing. It is meant to be purposefully bare, direct, straight, without any embellishment, without any trailing effect anywhere at all. Neither of sound, nor of simile, nor of metaphor or symbol, nothing. It is meant to be purposefully. And he says that, I am not going to change even a single word in this line. I am not going to change even a single word in this line. Even if you offer me the entire income of a Nobel laureate. Kavi Samrat, the income of a Kavi Samrat and Nobel laureate, even if you are going to offer it to me, I am not going to change anything at all in this line. Amal Kiran wanted to make a change in this one. He says, sorry, I am not going to change anything at all. It is meant to be purposefully bare. And such lines are very rare in Savitri itself. Such bare, direct, no trailing, nothing. Therefore, when you are reading that line, you will not read, this was the day even Satyavan must die. You will not read it all. You simply read, this was the day even Satyavan must die. See, quietly. See. It has its own power and its own effect also, you see. This was the day, this was the day. See, I mean, you are making unnecessarily emphatic and all that. They take away the charm of the bareness which is there in the line itself. Not only in words, but also in the pronunciation, you see. Must die. You see, must die could be easily a pandi. But here, it will not be appropriate to speak of a pandi. It will be, this was the day when Satyavan must die. This is a very bare line. One of the barest line. And Shivanu says in a letter, I am not going to change anything at all in this line, even if you are going to give me the whole kingdom of a poet laureate to see, income of a poet laureate. I am not interested in that. So emphatic it is. Actually, if you read this line along with a similar statement which we have in the Book of Fate, 106.146, the Queen Mother, Savitri's mother, is insisting Nara to tell what is the problem with Satyavan. He has spoken in a very vague term and he is not going to tell anything directly at all. She says, let me know if it is evil, even then speak so that we can prepare ourselves and be ready for the evil, to meet the evil. She is insisting upon that. You see. And in response to that, Narada replies, 12 swift-winged months are given to him and her. 12 swift-winged months are given to him and her. He is very specific about that. 12 swift-winged months are given to him and her. So he is making it very specific now. This moment, this hour, etc., etc. They will be only together after the marriage for 12 months. Means, actually, 12 swift-winged months, 1 year is important. Why 12 months? Why not tomorrow? Why not immediately or after a few years? Why is making specifically 1 year? Because the love of Satyavan Savitri, their togetherness, should pass through all the cycles of the season. He should meet all the seasons of time. All the symbolically, samvatsara or year, it means that the complete cycle of the seasons. It must go through the complete cycle of the seasons. You should see, obviously, first the seasons start here, grishma, summer, then rainy season, winter, due time, there are vasanta, six seasons in Indian cycle like that. So it should go through all the six seasons. Then the life's completeness is assumed there. And when you are seeing the life's completeness, then Satyavan is ready to die. After seeing life's completeness, fullness, he is now ready to go to another kind of a life after death. He goes the entire cycle of time here. So 12 swift-winged months, actually, one would have said 1 year, but his poetry does not allow that, 1 year, you see. 12 swift-winged months, all the seasons. There are six seasons, each season of about 2 months, you see, in Indian cycle of time, you see. And therefore he says, 12 swift winds are given. And then he says, this day returning, Satyavan must die. See, this is exactly the same phrase. This day returning, when Satyavan must die. This day returning. See, practically the same line, same sentence here. This day, instead of that, returning. This day returning. Satyavan must die. Now, you see the difference between this line and this line. this day returning Satyavan Mastai is not really bare. Although the words, everything is practically the same, that returning does not have that kind of a bareness, you see. It has some kind of other association which it is carrying along with it, you see. This day returning, Satyavan must die. There is a difference between this line and Nara. Otherwise, both the lines are practically identical in construction, you see. But the bareness which is there in 2.42 is not there in 106.146. You see the difference between the quality of poetry? The quality of poetry is different. This day returning, Satyavan must die. This was the day when Satyavan must die. The tone is different again. Here, the tone is different. This day returning. Narada is kind of saying emphatically, it must happen. This day returning, Satyavan must die. With that bareness is not there here. You see. How things change by single word, you see, the quality of poetry, you see. See, this line, this day returning, Satyavan must die, misses that kind of thing. In fact, I was trying to find out whether there are similar lines at all in Savitri, in epic Savitri, with such a bareness and very difficult. I think this is the only single line in the whole description. See, even the opening line, 1.1, this was the hour before the gods awake. It is a kind of a bare line, yet it doesn't have the kind of a bareness which is here in this line. This was the day when Satyavan must die. This was the hour before the gods awake. It doesn't have that bareness. It is trailing, it is carrying some kind of lot of background behind it. Here it is coming like a bare statement. This was the hour before the gods awake. It is a very simple line also, but it doesn't have that bareness. Similarly, the other famous line, 1.17, all can be done if the God touches there. It is a very simple, straightforward line. All can be done if the God touches there. It is also almost bare, yet it doesn't have the kind of a bareness which you have got here. This was the day when Satyavan must die. See, like that, if you find some other line, it will be very good with this sort of bareness which is there. I was trying to look for some line, but it's not. Some color is there, some trailing effect is there, some image is there, which is not going to make it so bare as this line seems. This was the hour before the gods awake. You are carrying a lot of history behind it already in that line. You see, it is not bare at all. You see. There is enormous history behind. The entire history of involution and evolution is there in a single line. In a single line, you see. See the other line also. 91.9. Ashwapati receiving the boon from the Divine Mother. Yes, one shall descend. He says that. One shall descend. And then she says finally, a seed shall be sown in this tremendous hour. It is pertaining to this tremendous hour. A seed shall be sown in this tremendous hour. A branch of heaven transplanted to human soil. At that time this will happen. Nature shall only her mortal step. Fate shall be changed by an unchanging will. Now, fate shall be changed by an unchanging will. There is no bareness at all. You see, it is carrying a lot of meaning. Same as the very first line, a seed shall be sown in this tremendous hour. A seed shall be sown in this tremendous hour. There is a certain kind of a bareness in it, yet not this. This was the day when Satyavan must die. A seed shall be sown in this tremendous hour. A lot of load is there in that line. A seed shall be sown in this tremendous hour. This was the day when Satyavan, a seed shall be sown in this tremendous hour. A seed shall be sown in this tremendous hour. It means that it is already anticipating a lot of things to come out of that thing, out of that seed. Seed is going to sprout and bring out some fruits or rewards, you see. In other words, this was the day when Satyavan must die. This line shows that this is a highly charged death. Satyavan's death, the whole description means that it's a highly charged death. A lot of contents are present in that. Although it is bare, it is yet full of charge, you see, a lot of contents are there. It is a design, a death. This was the day when Satyavan must die. This is a designed, a purposeful death. It must happen. It's a designed death. In that charge, this was the day when Satyavan must die. Now, what is the charge behind that death? There is a double yoga tapasya behind this death. The double yoga tapasya of Ashwapati approaching the Divine Mother and asking for the boon, and of Savitri conquering death. So that is the double yoga tapasya which is present in this charged death of Satyavan. Now there is one more point. You see that thing. Shivandu says, you see, about this line. Bare and straightforward line without any trailing of luminous ropes. Shivandu's words. This is a line, bare and straightforward line without any trailing of luminous ropes. There is no other line like this in Savitri, in my opinion. A line which I would not remove from its position, even if you were to give me the crown and income of the Kavi Samrat. Here is bareness, not for the sake of bareness. You want to make a line bare, therefore it's not there. But for the sake of the expression. The power with which a thing can be said. It is bare, not bald. And he says, it was more just, perfect line, correct line, for expressing for what I had to say in a certain context. It is exactly, just exactly what I had to say. This is a very plain, simple avowal, a bare assertion. This was the day when Satyavan must die. Now, let's go back to 106.3, which you want to do. 108.3. See, the queen gave a long, big speech. For 20 minutes she was speaking. Is this the kind of God you have here? We're so cruel. Is this the God who enjoys our suffering? What kind of God is it, you see? When she was told, when she heard from Narad that Satyavan is going to die, her husband, Savitri's husband, her lover, is going to die 1 year after the marriage. Then she says, what kind of cruel God is it, you see? And Narad sets himself now to give a long answer for about 1.5 hours, you see. And then he says, bear in that, see, Narad, then after the silence, okay, let us read from the first line. Then after the silence, Narad made reply, tuning his lips to earthly sound, he spoke. See, he is a sage from paradise, tuning his lips to earthly sound, and something now, the deep sense of fate, weighted the fragile hinge of mortal spirit. His forehead shone with vision solemnized, turned to a tablet of the supernal thorn, as if characters of an unknown tongue had left in its breath the inscriptions to the God. So what he sees, he's reading the inscriptions to God. There in that light, when he sees now, in there in that light, time toys. His unseen was detected. Time toys. Time is toiling for what? Time is toiling for this moment to arrive. Time is toiling. This was the day when Satyavan must die to arrive. Time is toiling for that. Through the ages, through the eons, time is waiting for this moment. Time, there in that light, time toil. His unseen was detected. His time's unseen was, Narada has detected. And he says, this was the day when Satyavan must die. This day returning, Satyavan must die. He says, he has detected, his unseen words, Narada has detected the unseen words of time. The broad-flung, far-seeing scheme unfinished, which his aeon flight unrolled, which his aeon, his time's aeon flight unrolled, were mapped already in that worldwide look. Narada's vision of the whole thing, he has already seen in that sweep of time, And in the last sweep of time, what do you see? This day returning, such one must die. This is what he has detected. Narada has detected this in the sweep of time.
So what Ashwapati did not Ashwapati did not tell about savagery to his queen. No. He kept it all for himself.
Yes. Well, I mean, they were sitting all together. They were hearing, listening. But she is she who raised the voice, who challenged Narada.
But he does not tell her who Savitri is. Because he knows, but the queen doesn't know.
No, Savitri, Ashwapati does not know. Narada has told specifically, this day returning, Satyavan must die.
But Ashwapati knows Savitri is a very special child.
Yes. But the specificity of an event in the life, all those details, he may not be aware.
That's true, but he did not tell anything to the queen.
Why should he? Because Narada is explaining everything.
No, before, when the Savitri was born, when she was a small child and all this, he may have told her Savitri is a special child.
No,
she
knows that he was engaged in tapasya, he wanted a child and all that. Obviously, she was aware of the whole thing. She is a participant also in his yoga. She is described as Ashwapati's queen and wise mother. See, he described very highly about her.
But she doesn't know who.
But she, when this moment came, then all that thing gone. You see, because it cannot be anything more cruel than that for a mother to see the widowhood of her own daughter. Which mother will accept? So, all gone to the wind. You see, that is part of the story. But in fact, if you remember, in the original story of the Mahabharata, Savitri's mother is not present anywhere at all in the dialogue, in the conversation. It is entirely between Ashwapati and Narada. Entirely, all these things. Not too many shlokas, but the whole dialogue is between Ashwapati and Narada. Because the queen knows that he will take care of everything properly. According to the old tradition, husband will take care of everything, so why should I interfere? She will not intrude at all, anything at all. You see, he will take care, she will take care of everything, you see. So that was the kind of a confidence she had in her husband, you see.